Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Mrinmay Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today we will discuss a module from a literary translation in India, and the title of the module is Translation and the Idea of Indian Literature. Let us begin with two comments on the idea of Indian literature and its relation with translation. One is made by Uday Naren Singh and the other one is made by K. Satchidanandan. Let me quote. Uday Naren Singh comments, "The major modern Indian languages have developed not only through vertical translations from the languages of power and knowledge, English and Sanskrit, but also by engaging in horizontal translations of one another, ultimately contributing to the creation of an inherently pluralistic body of literature in India." Now, let us talk about the second comment made by K. Satchidanandan. Satchidanandan comments, "With India's plurilingual heritage, translation, with its accretions, adaptations, and substitutions, was often a reinterpretation of the original. It continues to be a way of having a living dialogue with our past and between our different cultures." Through these two comments, we can understand that one thing, there is a long heritage of translation in Indian literature, and the other thing is that Indian literature have been grown and developed not only with the translation from Sanskrit and English, but also with the translation from one Indian language to another. And this is how, through translation, the idea of Indian literature has been formed. India practices translation in its tradition. Historically, traditionally, and culturally, India is multilingual. People in different classes necessarily interact with more than one languages, and thus translation is daily purpose of the Indian communities. If we see the life of the workers or daily wage laborers or the migrant workers, we can understand that they are traveling from one linguistic zone to another, and they are adapting the language of their workplace, and this is how they are engaged with work of translation knowledge. If we see the history of literary translation in India, it can be observed that multilingual existence and understanding is so common in the history of Indian literature. Sanskrit play of Kalidasa used not only Sanskrit but also different dialects of Prakrit as the language of the play. Such multilingual presence of language in a single play helps to understand the multilingual coexistence of the communities in ancient Indian society. If we read the Abhangs by Marathi Sant poet Tukaram, we can observe multilingual flavor in his text as he traveled from west to the north of India and wrote his Abhangs. The epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata are two such texts which are denominator of Indian literature as a whole, as these texts are widely adapted and translated not only in written form but also in oral traditions of different linguistic communities. The very beginning of Indian Bhasha literature is with or because of translation only. The growth and development of Indian Bhasha literature happened through translation of Sanskrit, Prakrit, Pali, Persian literature and knowledge text mainly. Literature written in these aforementioned languages is common in translation in almost all the modern Indian languages. Hence, translation is so integral in Indian literature, it is so obvious and it is so natural. Without the study of translation, it is not only difficult, but it is certainly impossible to imagine Indian literature. One side, Indian literature is commonly made with the translation of different ancient and medieval Indian literatures, and in other side, since the British era, Indian literature developed with the translation of European genres, themes, and direct translation of European literatures. Not only this, but there are a whole lot of instances of translation between Indian languages, which also helps not only in the development of single Indian literature, but also helps to imagine Indian literature as a whole. What is Indian literature? The answer of this question is not as difficult as its scope. The literature which is produced in India, written or orally created by Indians or by Indian origins or by the person of Indian diaspora in Indian languages, is Indian literature. Indian literature, when the nomenclature is used in singular number, also signifies the multiplicity of the literature. It holds the polyphony of Indian literature. Indian literature does not mean any single Indian literature or literature written in any single Indian language, but it is a phrase, a cluster, an identity which includes any literature recognized as Indian with some established norms of defining Indian literature. But when an Ao speaking person is practicing Ao literature only, we really do not mean it as practicing Indian literature. But when Ao speaking person is practicing Ao literature along with literature written in two or three more languages, like in Khasi, in Kokborok, in Oriya, or in Sindhi, we mean it as practicing Indian literature. Indian literature does necessarily mean crossing the linguistic boundary of any single Indian language. All the single literature departments, like Department of Bengali, Department of Gujarati, Kannada, Department of Assamese, etc., together are called as Department of Indian Literature. But a Department of Bengali cannot be called as Indian literature. It means Indian literature necessarily involves the practice of more than one or two languages and literature. How do we imagine Indian literature? When a literary text crosses its linguistic or cultural border, it exists for others. For example, as long as a text written in Maithili is not translated into Santhali, does not exist for the Santhalis. If none of the text translated into Santhali, it is too difficult or hardly possible to a Santhali reader who has only access to the Santhali language to imagine Indian literature. Our imagination of Indian literature as it is written in innumerous number of languages only possible when it does exist in a common language for all the linguistic communities, or at least cross the linguistic border of the origin of the text. By saying this, I do not mean that all the literatures produced in all the languages should be translated into all the languages to get the status of Indian literature or to form the identity of Indian literature. But rather, I argue that a particular text should be translated, or at least the information of the text should be reached in one more or few other languages. And thus, all existing Indian languages become the treasure of translation. The quantity may vary from language to language, but all the languages has its own treasure or own collection of translation of other Indian literatures. If any language of India, as it is case in the most of the languages who do not have their own script, does not have its tradition or treasure of translation, it is too hard to imagine Indian literature for them. So, for imagining Indian literature, if the translation is one of the most powerful purpose or only purpose in popular practice, or only way to serve our purpose easily, then a particular language should have its culture of writing, its own script. If there is no script in a particular language, then it is very difficult for that language to make a treasure of Indian literature, to imagine Indian literature from their location. Though there are some other agencies like multilingual book fairs, travel of literary figures of different languages in different linguistic zones also helps us to imagine Indian literature, like Indian Literary Meet, Indian Literary Festival, where literary figures from different languages, across the languages, meet together, they read the literary text. So this is how we can imagine Indian literature. We can have the flavor and taste of different kind of Indian literatures. But these are not focus of our discussion here in this module. Our focus is very clear that we are talking about translation and how translation is building the idea, notion, conception of Indian literature. Now let us talk about independence and Indian literature. How the phenomena of independence brings the difference in imagination of Indian literature or national literature. After the inauguration of India as an independent nation state on that momentous midnight of 14th to 15th August in 1947, Indian literature became a nationalist desideratum. If it did not already exist, it appeared that it had to be invented. The Sahitya Academy, National Academy of Letters, set up in 1955 at a meeting presided over by the Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru and addressed by the then Education Minister Abul Kalam Azad, so evolved as to have in time for its agenda the affirmation of an integrated, if not unified entity, called Indian literature. The English language bi-monthly journal of the Academy is titled Indian Literature, while its Hindi journal is called Samkalin Bharatiya Sahitya or Contemporary Indian Literature. Both journals represent in translation the whole range of literature in all the major Indian languages, commented by Harish Trivedi. Now, from this comment, you can understand the immediate project what was taken after the independence of India, that is imagining the national literature, Indian literature, and this was very much political agenda to imagine a nation through its literature. And this is how the whole cluster of national literature and the whole cluster of Indian literature structurally emerged. And to serve this purpose, government established two institutions which will help to imagine Indian literature or imagine national literature as to make the nation state more strengthened, more stronger. And those institutions are Sahitya Academy and National Book Trust. Let us talk about comparative Indian literature and translation. In fact, comparative Indian literature is a term often used as if it were virtually synonymous with Indian literature. The comment made by Harish Trivedi. When we talk about comparative Indian literature, we really talk about the discipline where we do practice Indian literature. There are few more nomenclatures of similar kind, like Indian comparative literature in India. All these nomenclatures, though, are similar in significance, but do not stand for exact meaning. When we claim study of Indian literature in the basis of comparative methodology, we mean comparative Indian literature. When we claim a distinctive school of comparative literature, like as French School of Comparative Literature, American Comparative Literature, British Comparative Literature, German Comparative Literature, or Indian Comparative Literature. We mean Indian Comparative Literature, which certainly believes in some distinctive methods or area of focus. And when we use comparative literature in India, we talk about the established discipline of comparative literature in India and the state of the discipline, method and curriculum and syllabus, etc. Different departments of comparative literature and comparative Indian literature necessitates the work of translation for imagining Indian literature. I took 1919 as the beginning of this period, as in this year, the modern Indian languages department was established in the University of Calcutta, and I consider this initiative as the systematic beginning of practice of Indian literature in India. When I'm talking about this discipline, there is a very intrinsic relation between this discipline, the study of Indian literature, and translation. The then Vice Chancellor of the Calcutta University proposed that now we have to know, we have to understand our own literature. There are innumerable literature produced in different Indian languages, and we have to read all those to know ourselves, to know better about our own country, about our own people. And from this very ideology, from this philosophy, Ashutosh Mukherjee established this Department of Comparative, Department of Modern Indian Languages. And most of the major Indian languages were studied there. And Ashutosh Mukherjee actually published books of those languages and published books in translation from the press of Calcutta University, from the British press, and from different other press. So this is how a discipline of modern Indian languages actually, from its very beginning, showed its necessity of translation. And later on, when Jadavpur University established in 1956 and it introduced comparative literature as its discipline, from that time we can till the date we can find that there are lots of works have been done on translation. And there is one center called Center for Translation in Indian Literature. From there, different Indian literature, different Indian tribal literature are translated into Bengali. And this is how the idea of Indian literature, the diversity of Indian literature is not only practiced, but in some way it is established again and again through the work of translation. The Department of Comparative Indian Literature in Delhi University, in Guwahati University, and in Calcutta University, Comparative Indian Language and Literature, all these departments are practicing Indian literature through translation mainly, either in English or in any other Indian languages. And this is how we experienced that translation is the only way to offer Indian literature as a course to the students from different linguistic background of India. And this is how the theorization of Indian literature and the idea of Indian literature is actually promoted through the study of Indian literature in translation. This module also needs to discuss the publications and other initiatives regarding translation and the role of different publishing houses, including Sahitya Academy, National Book Trust, National Translation Mission, and various state academies for the promotion of literature, which are supported by central government and other state initiatives. These notions also takes up for discussion the initiative of private publication houses and their publishing of translations and the idea of Indian literature. The combined impact was to sensitize national awareness and spread of national literatures. In my view, the process of nation building is well served through the dissemination of literature, through the creation of such literary spaces, and the encouragement with translation. India is a multilingual country, and networking among many languages and literature is both imperative and essential for nation building. But not only translation and their publication or circulation, proactive and determined promotion of Indian literature, translation studies, and comparative literature must be emphasized for enhancing and enlarging the idea of nation and national literatures. Within the nomenclature of national literature is also included their translation. Now, let us talk about translation, publishing, and Indian literature. In this section, we'll discuss the initiative of different publication houses like Sahitya Academy, National Book Trust, and many other publication houses, and their role in publishing translation of Indian literature, and how those publication houses are trying to represent the marginal section of Indian society, how they are trying to represent the marginal Indian literature into the cluster of Indian literature or the canon of Indian literature, how the canon is shaping and reshaping, changing and changing again, and what is the role of publication houses to build an inclusive, an idea of inclusive Indian literature. We will discuss all these things. Sahitya Academy, which is known as National Academy of Letters, promotes that the Indian literature is one, though written in many languages. A famous mantra pronounced by once President of India and philosopher Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. And this is the motto of Sahitya Academy. So, Sahitya Academy publishes translation of different Indian literature into different Indian languages to build the one idea of Indian literature. The very existence and successful journey of Sahitya Academy proves that the translation is perhaps only one powerful medium to imagine one Indian literature, not ignoring the diversity and differences of Indian literature. National Book Trust is another publication house which also engages itself in the same purpose with different other purposes. National Academy, in its project called Adan Pradan, it translates Indian literatures from one language to another, and it circulates in cheap rate. Along with its translation project of Asian literature, world literature, and translation project of knowledge text. The new eagerness among writers and readers in India to know what is happening in languages other than their own can chiefly be attributed to the recent spurt in translations. Translations have begun to appear recently even from tribal languages that had so far been completely neglected, thanks to the initiative taken by Sahitya Academy and the interest of scholars like Ganesh Devi. We certainly need more translations of folk and tribal lore, wherein lie the solid foundations of our literature. Perhaps mutual translations among Indian languages are on the wane today because of a lack of competent bilingual scholars with the necessary skills and sensibility, except between some languages pairs. But this has been compensated to some extent by the increase in translations into English, thanks to the pioneering efforts of the Sahitya Academy and the National Book Trust, along with the new interest shown by private publishers like Oxford University Press, Penguin, Katha, Orient Black Swan, Orient Longman, Macmillan, East West, HarperCollins, Rupa, and many committed little publication houses like Navayana. This comment is made by K. Sachidanandan. Now, let us focus on National Book Trust. The objectives of National Book Trust are to produce and encourage the production of good literature in English, Hindi, and other Indian languages, and to make such literature available at moderate prices to the public and to bring out book catalogs, arrange book fairs, exhibitions, and seminars, and take all necessary steps to make the people book-minded. Their publishing agenda is, in furtherance to the above objectives, National Book Trust is mandated to publish the classical literature of India, outstanding works of Indian authors in Indian languages and their translation from one Indian languages to another, translation of outstanding books from foreign languages and outstanding books of modern knowledge for popular diffusion. National Book Trust publishes books under different series in English and in all major Indian languages of India, like Hindi, Oshomiya, Bangla, Gujarati, Kannada, Kashmiri, Konkani, Malayalam, Manipuri, Marathi, Nepali, Oriya, Punjabi, Rajasthani, Bhojpuri, Sindhi, Tamil, Telugu, and Urdu. In addition, National Book Trust also publishes select books for children in Vili, Gondi, Santhali, and some northeastern languages such as Ao, Naga, Bhutia, Boro, Garo, Khasi, Kokborok, Lepcha, Limbo, Missing, Mizo, and Newari. National Book Trust pays special attention to those genres which are not adequately covered by other publishers. Now, from this information which is provided on the website of National Book Trust and the comment on translation and Indian literature made by K. Sachidanandan, we can understand that our new journey towards Indian literature is by focusing on the marginal literature, on focusing on the folk literature and tribal literature, where the real essence of Indian literature actually lies. Because the modern Indian literature is the creation of hybridity. It's hybrid literature with the lots of encounters with European and other culture, and there are lots of influences, and there are lots of genres exported from other culture, and the Indian literature have been, Indian text have been, Indian writings have been fitted into those genres. So the exploration of tribal literature and folk literature is one of the prime agenda to find the common denominators of Indian literature. And this is how the imagination of Indian literature will be more historically rooted, and it will be more historically strengthened. And this is a journey. This is a journey. And what we can observe now, that our focus is going further to find the lost literature and lost literary culture, or the marginal literary cultures of India. Translations in India got a top shot in the 1980s when the Sahitya Academy started organizing translation workshops across the country. Moreover, Katha, an organization set up in 1989 based in Delhi, provided an added impetus to translations. These two translation organizations considered translations in and from 22 Indian languages and also retranslated the translated text into other Indian languages. Some of the earliest translated published texts are The Puppet's Tale, 1969 by Manik Bandyopadhyay from Bangla, Wild Bapu of Garambi in 1968 by Sridhar Pense from Marathi, and The Gora by Tagore. The Academy has also translated works of ancient Indian literature into English as well. The comment made by Ms. Carmen Natasha Viegas Perez. Now, from this comment, we can understand that there is a continuous practice of translation among Indian languages, and this practice actually emerges to have better understanding of Indian literature and to have access to Indian literature for the readers who have only access to Indian bhasha, and they are imagining their Indian literature from their bhasha practice, bhasha perspective, through this intra-Indian translation. Now let us talk about English translation and Indian literature, more specifically role of English in the translation of Indian literature. English translation of different Indian literatures published by Oxford University Press, Penguin, Orient Black Swan, sets up a cluster of representative Indian literature. Because English quite often appears as authentic. So some translation which has happened into English, it looks authentic in our mind, in popular notion. As translation of Indian literature from one Indian language to another is not much practice, English occupies the space. As a result, Indian literature written in different languages actually submitted in a common language, which is common to most of the linguistic communities. And thus, through English translation, a literary text produced in a certain language appears as common property for all others. Mini Krishnan, who is engaged with Oxford University Press and take care of translation of different Indian literatures into English, comments, in ultra-conservative Macmillan India, the first project I handled was a 4,000-page type script called Comparative Indian Literature, 2 volumes, a survey of all the literary forms from the recognized languages of the country. 17, at that time, managing 200 contributors, 17 language editors, and Dr. K.M. George, the chief editor, I went from harbor to the high seas in a month. By the time both volumes were published in 1985, I had made up my mind to try and publish at least modern Indian fiction in English translation. In the indigenous writing of the subcontinent lay the memories and history of a people who are rapidly losing their languages. What better service than to retrieve and reinterpret in a link language, creating a body of work which was emotionally important for India. And this was the necessity of translating Indian literature into different languages, or more specifically in English, as English shows its power and shows its wider readership and the market and the economy involved in it. The anthology which was prepared from the Macmillan called Comparative Indian Literature also helps to imagine the Indian literature. Also helps to make an idea of Indian literature. And this is how the anthologies, the collection of works, collected works or selected works of Indian literature help Indian reader to make an idea of Indian literature. And not only the anthology which is mentioned here and published from Macmillan, but other anthologies published by Oxford University Press, published by National Book Trust, published by Sahitya Academy also helped to imagine Indian literature. And we can find a whole lot of information about Indian literature. And this collection of information, this representation of information actually strengthen the idea of Indian literature in the mind of readers. And from this comment of Mini Krishnan, we can understand that how the translation into English of the losing culture or losing languages or losing literature of India was important, and that initiative helps a wider reader to know about the losing Indian literature, language and culture, or the marginal Indian language and culture. We can find the Katha organization to take a similar kind of initiative. Katha, a non-profit organization working with and in story and storytelling for 22 years now, has more than 300 published titles, including quality translations of fiction for adults and children, 21 Indian languages in the voices of over 600 writers and translators. On the other end of the creative spectrum is Katha Publishing Program that bolsters the reading initiative by producing books that create space for culturally distinctive literature and celebrate the glorious polyphonous multiplicity that is India, with every carefully chosen and published title. Quality has been single major idea that drives Katha. Katha have constantly reinvented ourselves to stay focused on our mission, re-engineered our work to deliver the maximum impact, written on the website of Katha as the mission and the agenda of Katha Publisher. From this note about the Katha Publisher, what the website says, we can understand that the making of Indian literature through translation is not only to promote the political agenda of national literature or the oneness of Indian oneness of literature, but it promotes all the diversity, all the polyphony, all the multiplicity of Indian literature, but all those are published in English. So English takes a very powerful step, or English contributes very powerfully in imagining Indian literature with its all the polyphony and the multiplicity, as the publishing houses are very much concerned about the multiplicity and polyphonic nature of Indian literature. This is how English translation of Indian literature helps us to understand the polyphonic Indian literature, and the literature reaches to the wider audience of different communities, because as English is the common language or the lingua franca for communicating among the Indians. The similar kind of initiatives are taken by Kali for Women, Navayana, Sri, Samya, all these publication houses, what publishes translation of different Indian literature, especially the Indian literature from the gender perspective, from the Dalit perspective, and from Indian literature from Northeastern India. So all these publication houses are contributing a lot to promote more inclusive Indian literature. The whole narrative of translation and publishing in post-independent India brings polyphonic voices in the sphere of Indian literature. Enough time, no? Okay. Now let us conclude our discussion. Translation is not only integral to imagine the Indian literature, but it is also inseparable from the idea of Indian literature. We cannot imagine Indian literature, or idea of Indian literature cannot be existed in concrete, if there is no translation among Indian languages, or translation of Indian literature in common language called English, or there is no history of common reception from Sanskrit, Pali, Prakrit, Persian, and English. But in this tradition of formation of Indian literature also has translation in its popular sense, is literary translation. Hence, those languages which do not have their own script, or not have even the Roman scripts as their writing culture, is hard to be included in the structure of Indian literature. Though oral traditions can be recorded in different written languages, but literary records do not possible in other way. But our journey towards imagining Indian literature is to be more inclusive, and we need inclusive conceptualization. According to Shishir Kumar Das, our idea of national literature is partly a recognition of relationship existing between the people and the literature, but only partly, unquote. This very comment of Indian literature states both the side of Indian literature as national literature, which is existing in translation and which is not. Thank you.